bless your name this morning. Yes, God, as we stand in your house, as we stand together, we make this declaration that we will rejoice in the Lord always. As Paul encouraged the church, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, he said, and again I say, rejoice in the Lord. So today, God, as we stand before you, we make a choice that no matter what I'm going through or standing in, I will rejoice in you. I'm gonna dance and praise you no matter what comes my way. We bless your name. Hallelujah. We're gonna rejoice in this house. Hallelujah. Because he comes and he sits in our praises. He comes and he sits in our praises. God, we say, come. Our hearts are open. Come. Come. Be glorified. Be lifted up. Be exalted. Yes. Come, Lord God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm gonna dance and praise him. So we're gonna put our hands together. And this song is a call and response. We're gonna teach you this song. The songwriter said, I'm gonna dance and praise him no matter what comes my way. Hallelujah. We rejoice in the goodness of our God. Because he is good, I can rejoice. Because he sits on the throne.
Greater one lives in his name is Jesus. do things our way, but because he is God, because he sits on the throne, and no weapon that is formed against us will prosper because of who he is. Not because of me, but because of who he is. Hallelujah. So I rejoice even in the dark times and in the valley. We make a declaration because the Lord is good, because his mercy endures forever, because he sits, Jesus sits at the right hand of power. We rejoice. We rejoice. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, because of who you are, we rejoice. We rejoice. We know that you are the way maker, and you make a way according to how you have predestined, according to your own counsel, yes, according to your will, yes, God. So we can rejoice because your thoughts towards us are good, yes, to give us a hope and a future. So we can rejoice. We're more than conquerors. So we can speak the name. His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We're gonna speak the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. The name that is above every name. Demons tremble at the name. We love the name of Jesus. Let's make some declarations. I just want to speak the name. Over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Your name is love.
Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus, we declare it today. Shout Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains. Jesus,
Jesus, you call us to come You have drawn back the curtains and you say, come. Come past the place of thanksgiving. Come past the place of praise into my presence, into the holies of holies. Hallelujah. And we bow at your feet. Yes, God. Hallelujah. We leave all else behind. Oh, God. We leave all else behind. We pour out our love. Let's sing this. My devotion. My affection. Poured out at the feet of Jesus. Yes, God.
I just want to honor the pastor here at this church, Pastor Steve Malazzo. I call him a friend, and the reason why is because during the pandemic, everybody was having a difficult time, and my boss told me and that we need some footage out there to see how the people are doing in a pandemic. You want me to get some footage? How am I going to get some footage in a pandemic? That don't even make no sense. But I went into prayer and fasting, and I'm telling you that God showed me Pastor Malazzo. I called him up. I said, can you help me now? Thank you. He, as you know, all of you know, he's a pastor of a megachurch. Most pastors of a megachurch don't even answer your call. But he answered my call and he helped me. And these videos that they were able to create here was what we used to minister people around the country. And so I just want to say, and I say it all the time, and that I absolutely love and respect and admire this pastor. He is a man of integrity. His steps are ordered by the Lord. He listens to the Lord. So you're in the right place if this is your church. Let's pray. Father God, we come to continue to give you glory and to give you honor. I come today, Father, because I can't do this without you. Holy Spirit, if you're not here with me, it's just a speech and it's not a message. Today, Father, I am believing, I'm coming in agreement with my previous prayer that, Father, that the word is going to fall on good ground, that your daughters will not leave the same. Some of them come in here, Father, they're looking good, but they're heavy. But we declare in the name of Jesus that they will have an encounter with you that will literally change their lives. Father, I pray that you be with me, Holy Spirit. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. Now look at your sister and say, you look good. Did you lose weight? Now look back at her and say, no, it's just the joy of the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, our theme, finding strength in the Lord for our journey. And it comes from Nehemiah 8:10. You know, we read it, but it's okay that we read it again, because I don't know about you, but I look at the cooking channel over and over and over again. Nehemiah 8:10. Then he said to them, go your way. This is Nehemiah talking. Eat the fat, drink the sweet, and send portions to those for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy to our Lord. Do not sorrow, for the joy of the Lord is our strength, or some say our salvation. Now, in order, the question that we need to answer this morning, there's two of them, is how did Nehemiah finds strength in the Lord for his journey? And the second question we need to answer is, how do we find strength in the Lord for ourselves, for our journey? That's the question that has to be answered. And so what we're going to do is that we're going to go and look at the story of Nehemiah. Okay? And so I'm going to be paraphrasing, but I want you to go home and schedule. Because if I don't schedule something, I'm not going to do it. Can I just talk to you? Oh, I'm going to talk to you, okay? You probably won't invite me again, but I'm going to definitely talk to you. When I say I'll call you back, if I don't schedule it, I'm not going to call you back. I'm just going to forget. I'm so glad that we can be honest with each other. And so this is where we find ourselves. Jerusalem was like many cities, other cities. They had this tall, thick wall built around them, and the gates and the wall would allow entrance into Jerusalem. But what happened was the gates were destroyed, and it left them very vulnerable for people to attack them. So I'm not surprised how devastated Nehemiah was when his brother Hanani told him that the walls and the gates have been destroyed. This is what Nehemiah says in 1:3. This is his brother Hanani talking to Nehemiah. Things are not going well for those who return to the province of Judah. They are in great trouble and distress. The wall of Jerusalem has been torn down and the gates have been destroyed by fire. You can put up the next slide. When Nehemiah heard this, he wept and cried and prayed and fasted for days as he began to intercede, not just for his nation, but for the family and for himself, because of the sins that they had committed against God. I can just hear him right now praying, Lord, you are great and you are mighty. Remember you told Moses, your servant, that if we disobeyed you, that you would scatter us among the nations. But you said if we would come back to you, if we obeyed you, that you would bring us back to a place where your name is honored. There are some of us, Father, and I'm one of them, who honor your name, who delight in you. So please answer my prayer. After crying out to the Lord, he set on a mission to rebuild the wall and the gates of Jerusalem, even though it meant walking away from his prestigious job. Can you imagine, as the cupbearer, you got a good job making over $150,000 a year with all your benefits, and you gonna walk away. In other words, yeah, he decided to walk away. In other words, Nehemiah decided to fight back. That's why I got these gloves right here. Oh yeah, okay. I got my fatigues on and stuff. I can't put them both on at the same time and flip my cards and all of that. And so I'm just going to tell you how it may look when you get ready for battle. It kind of looks like this. Oh yeah, you coming after me and my stuff? I'm going to get you. I'm going to fight back. Don't you mess with me, I'll slap you down in the name of the Lord. I'm going to tell you, can we talk? Because I think we can talk. You should have seen the dress I had. Ooh, I was going to be looking fine today. You should have seen me. And then I was talking to my daughter, and she said, you going to wear what? This ain't the Church of God in Christ. You ain't got a hat or nothing, do you, mommy? So at the last minute, I said, hey, I'm in battle. So I'm going to come like I'm in battle. So that's why I got on my fatigue, because I'm ready to fight. Let's get back to the story. Now, I can't keep these on, you know, because I can't flip, right? Okay, so we're just going to put them right here. Feel free if you feel like it, feel free and come get the gloves and fight with me, okay? First of all, he began by asking the king to support him, his boss, in the mission. He said, what I need you to do is to give me some paper so that I can be protected and I can get the things that I need to build the wall. And then he said, I got to go inspect the wall. Now, I want you to think about that. He was devastated. He cried out to the Lord. He was praying and fasting. And now he goes to the wall. And it looks bad. Can you imagine your house, wherever you stay, you go there and it's just all torn down. Imagine just how people feel in hurricanes. Everything is torn down. But what he did, what I loved about it, he didn't stay there. He went and gathered all the men of the Jewish men, and he said, listen, I got to tell you what I found. It doesn't look good. The wall is down. The gate is down. It doesn't look good. And this is what the men said. They said, we are going to help you build. In other words, they said, let's build. Don't fear. Don't be afraid. Even when you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I am with you. My rod and my staff will comfort you. Don't worry. I have not forgotten you. Your name is written in the palm of my hand, and that's when you got to keep on fighting. The reason why Sanballat planned to kill Nehemiah's plan didn't work because he heard the voice of the Lord. If you're in this relationship with God, you're going to have to be able to hear his voice. One of the things my mama told me, she said, baby, you hear, but you don't listen. Okay, I told you to bring back a loaf of bread, and I told you to bring Wonder, and you brought Stroman. You got to be real old to know about Wonder Bread and about Stroman, because what I heard was bread, but I didn't listen that she told me. You got to be able to listen. Nehemiah, he was working hard, but he heard the voice of the Lord warning him. This is what happened. Sanballat. I done tried a couple times to knock this boy down, and he's still standing. Them crazy people still building the wall, so I'm going to send somebody else. And that's when he sent Geshem, and Geshem said, listen, man, you know that we got to hide because they're going to kill us. So come on with me, okay? Come on with me, and we'll both be protected. That's some of the schemes that the enemy uses against young people. Come on. It ain't going to hurt you. We're just going to go to this party. We're just going to have a little bit to drink. It ain't going to hurt you. Your mama ain't going to know. But because he heard the voice of God, he had an intimate relationship with him, he knew that that was not a good plan. Go on about yourself with your ugly. Yeah, you can call the enemy ugly too. He won't call you ugly. Call him ugly too with your stupid self. You don't really think I was going to fall for that stupid, stupid, idiotic plan. Let's get back to the story because as you can see, I get excited. It wasn't easy, but Nehemiah and the men restored the wall and the gates of Jerusalem. Put up slide 3. I was a little bit slow in the slides. You can go to the next slide where they were working, and then you can go to the next slide when they were celebrating. It's time to celebrate. Everyone gathered together to hear the word of the Lord read by Ezra the priest. They were worshiping God and praising him, and I believe that they were doing just a little bit of dance, giving God all the glory and all the honor. Can you just see them? All these people, they just worshiping and praising God, but then they became sad because they remembered the sins that they had committed. Now, catch this, ladies. Governor Nehemiah, He started out unemployed because, you know, he quit his job. But now he's the governor. And he stood up and said, don't be sad. This is a special day for the Lord. The joy of the Lord will make you happy and strong. Now it's time to answer the question. Now, how do we find joy and strength from the Lord in our journey when our enemies try to bully us, destroy our self-esteem, and lure us into a trap that will kill us? The answer is that you fight back with praise. You praise him for what he's done and for what he has and that he will do. I wish I had somebody that would get excited about this. You worship him simply because of who he is, and then you pray. And this is the thing. Prayer is a two-way thing, okay? For years, can I get closer now? I got some people at Harvest here. Don't you go back and tell them what I'm getting ready to say. This is how I used to pray when I was just a surface Christian. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just thank you for everything you've done for me. And I just pray that you get me to my boyfriend Larry's house, Father, so we can spend the weekend. I just pray that you get me safely back so I can lead the praise and worship team. Okay, God, and about my tithe, I did pay it on Sunday, but I really do need it back on Thursday because I really don't have no money. I just thank you, God, and I give you glory and honor because you are God, and besides you, there is none other. And God, the other thing I need, I just need you to help me with my bills. There was a sale, there was a sale at Macy's, and I spent a little bit of my blood, but I know that there's nothing too hard for you when you give it back to me in Jesus' name. Yeah, I'm going to be honest with you. That's how I used to pray. But what happened is I realized that the relationship with God is not like a monologue. It's a dialogue. It's between that he speaks to me and I speak to him. And that's when you know that you have a relationship with God, because in his prayer he'll say, daughter, you done lost your mind, but I love you anyhow. You know God don't use that type of language. The other thing is, if you want to know how to find joy in your journey with the Lord, you're going to have to read the word. And it's not your devotion for 5 minutes. It's not while I'm on the train, I'm going to read the Lord. I'm going to read the Bible. This is the thing. Can I be honest with you again? I schedule a time to eat. I'm going to be honest with you. Matter of fact, I wake up in the morning, even the night before, I'm going to prepare what I'm going to have to eat, because I know that at 12 o'clock, I'm going to turn off my phone, because if my boss calls, I don't want to be disrespectful. So I'm going to turn off my phone because I'm scheduling a time and that I'm going to eat this beautiful lunch that I have prepared. I'm a foodie, so you can imagine what my lunch looks like. That's what you need to do with the word. You need to schedule time to read the word. And this is what I do. I also hear it, because faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. You want to find strength in your journey. You want to get strength from the Lord. It's developing an intimate relationship with him. And these are the things that you need. So listen, we need to get back to the story. Rejoice. The journey was tough, but the men, they made it, because the joy of the Lord is their salvation. Now, they won, so you need to just say hallelujah, because they won. Oh, you can do better than that. Nehemiah won. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can I get a little bit deeper? What if you followed the lesson? I didn't go alone in my battle. I called up my sister's circle of prayer. I fought back with the word. And when the enemy was trying to talk to me, I just remember what God said about me. But my result wasn't like Nehemiah. My sister was diagnosed with brain cancer. Now, listen, I'm a prayer warrior. I'm a seasoned child of God. I'm eating meat. When the doctor gave her that diagnosis, I said, there's nothing too hard for the Lord. I know he's going to heal you. We went into prayer, into fasting, and we believe God, and she died. How do I find strength? How do I find joy in that journey? I am considered the spiritual leader of my family. And I said that if we speak things that are not as though they were, he's Jehovah Rapha, the healer, and his son is the great physician. And if we just come together, because when two or three are gathered in his name, he's in the midst of them. He is the one that raised people from the dead. Surely that Judy will make it, but she didn't. I found myself depressed and ashamed because I let my family down. They were looking at me and said, we did all of that and she died anyway. I remember something my mother said when she was sick. She said, it doesn't matter whether he heals me or not. He's still a healer. She said, I don't want to die right now, but death is not a period. It's a comma because I have a seat in the kingdom. I've reserved a spot. There's a mansion in there. No matter what you're going through, he doesn't change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So what was how did I find strength in this defeat? Remember, it wasn't like Nehemiah. The walls were completed. They were strong and everybody was rejoicing. We came together and to mourn her death and to celebrate her life. But the bottom line is the biggest celebration that Judy had, she wasn't even there. So I went to God carefully because my mama said, don't you try that mess about getting mad at God. But even if you do, let me tell you something. He's not intimidated by that.
That's right. That's right.
Okay? That's just a fear tactic from the enemy.
He's
not intimidated in that. I went to him and I cried out and I said, what joy is this? What did we learn? What happened here? He said, this is what happened on the journey. Over half of my family was not saved. During this journey, many of them accepted Christ as their Lord and their Savior. Many of them in the family, they were not speaking to one another because there was so much unforgiveness that was in their heart, but it prevented them from loving on one another. But during this journey, they went to each other and they said, I did some things to you and I'm asking for your forgiveness. This is what came out of the journey. Well, I didn't get the result that I wanted, but I still found strength in the journey because of my relationship with God. I come to tell you that there's some things you're not going to always win.
Right.
I don't always get my prayers answered. I remember when I went to fast. This is how I used to fast. When I needed a desperate answer from the Lord, I said, listen, Lord, I need you to take care of this. So I'm going to give up all my favorite foods, my fried chicken, my salmon, my french fries, all of that. I'm going to put it for you. You know, God, I love this stuff, right? Okay. I'm going to put it before you because I need you to answer my prayer. Okay, 3 days. I'm going to do the Esther fast. Well, maybe not the Esther one, God, because I do want to eat something. I'll maybe do the Daniel I can eat. But matter of fact, I just need you to do what I, and I'm going to sacrifice. But what I found out, then I went to the Lord. I positioned myself to get an answer from him concerning my situation that's different. And when I go into that, when I have those crises, I realize that I was going into the fast for my sister wrong. I had to go in as, first of all, as fasting is a form of worship to him. I had to cry out to him and said, no matter what, I trust you. And I want to hear clearly from you because I'm sure that the answer I'm looking for is not the answer you're going to give me, but I trust you.
Amen.
It's not easy to worship like that.
Amen.
It's not easy to say, I love you, Lord. You're the lover, the bishop, and the shepherd of my soul. I love you, Lord. You're with me. You're my best friend that sticks closer than a brother. I love you, Lord. And in all of that, in losing my sister, I still could shout, hallelujah. Yeah. I still was able to shout hallelujah to him. I was still able to give him glory. I still was able to worship him because not because of what I need him to do, but because of who he is. I was crying and I was in pain. And every now and then in December, the December 1st when she dies, I cry.
it's okay. It's okay. Because I think about how God blessed me with this incredible woman. And even though that it was short, I can still say thank you, Jesus. I find strength in the journey because of my relationship with him. That's what I do. What I loved about the women that came up here today is that they were honest. See, what happens is that we want to put on this face. How you doing? I'm blessed and I'm highly favored. Girl, the Lord is with me. He'll make a way out of no way. I know him. You know he's Jehovah Jireh. He is my provider. I know him. He's my peace, Jehovah Shalom. Peace surpasses all understanding. But this is the problem. You know that he'll do it. But because of your circumstance you're in, you're not completely convinced he'll do it for you. It's okay for you to say, I am blessed and highly favored. The enemy is attacking me, but I'm going to stand on his word because it never changes. It's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I understand that we're going to go through some things, but I am not going to fall. You'd be surprised how people would appreciate that. Now, as pastors, you better not say that, Eunice. Hey, Pastor D, how you doing? Girl, I'm going through hell. You'd be saying, I don't know if she should be a pastor. She's going through a lot of stuff. Pastor Mitchell, maybe you should talk to Pastor D. When they called an altar call, she was the first one up there. I don't know, maybe she shouldn't be a leader. You know, I just don't know. She says she's paying her tithe, but it's just from the net and not the gross. I don't know if she should be able to be a leader. No matter what you're going through, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Rejoice. Stand on your feet and rejoice in the Lord. I know you're going through some situations. I know it doesn't look good for your marriage. I know your kids have turned into an alien. But I want you to rejoice in the Lord always. For the joy of the Lord is my salvation. I know your finances ain't looking right. And gas done went up. And food done went up. I told Harvest on Sunday, even salt went up to $2.99 a box, but I'm going to rejoice in the Lord always because the joy of the Lord is my salvation.
I've been at Bethlehem for 7 years. It is a blessing to me and my family. I'm so happy to see so many women. I love women because there's power in women. How many say amen to that? I don't know a woman that doesn't have a story. And I don't know a woman that doesn't have a good story. But a woman of God is especially special to me because you guys have overcome and been through and gone through and dragged someone else through. And it is inspiring to me. How many women are inspired by women? Amen? You know, in the world, they tell you you can't trust women. But how many people know that's a lie from the pits of hell? Iron sharpens iron, amen? And women can draw strength from each other, amen? When I saw these women turn out today, I was like, yeah! And COVID had us locked up and put away somewhere, but now we're back out and you look good. You look mighty good. You don't look like you've been through nothing, amen? And to God be the glory. I do have a PowerPoint, but I'm just gonna keep it moving because I don't see it. But the message, you gotta be ready, right? You gotta live ready. The message is about the journey. How many people like to take long journeys? Long road trips? Long airplane flights? My hand ain't up for none of that. I don't like none of that. I'm too hyper. I need to get where I'm going. I don't like none of that. But how many people know you don't have a choice in the kingdom? It's a journey, baby. From the time you're born to the time you meet him, it's a journey. Amen? And how many people know that God wants you to enjoy the journey? It's not all toils and snares. It's joy as well. There's wonderful things along this journey. Amen? How many people have experienced the good things? Amen. Don't forget about the good times. You need them to get through the what? The hard times. Amen. So let's talk about the journey. If you're going to journey, let's just say you could pick a car. What kind of car would you pick? Mercedes? BMW? BMW? Nobody said Toyota. No. No. Who said no? Honda? Tesla? Mustang? Hello? Lamborghinis? Porsches? Anybody? Listen, either way, you get to go on the ride of life. And you get to pick what you're going to take with you. How many people know how to pack for a journey? Women, you pack everything. How many people overpack? I know women who travel with pots and pans and I mean like hams and you know like chickens. I'm like, but where are you going? They ain't got no chicken. They take chickens with them. They ain't got no pots. They take pots with them. How many people? I hope this isn't being recorded. But then you got some women. I ain't gonna call no names. They go on the journey, they pack for their kids. I packed everything. I had everything ready. Then I got there, and guess what I forgot to pack? Where were my intimate garments? Oh, geez, I didn't have everything I needed. But my grandma was nice to me. She said, Sarette, I'll lend you mine. I said, no. No. So this breakout is about helping you to prepare for the journey, right? Now, most of us are halfway there, just halfway there. So by now, you should be carrying some of the stuff you need. For some of you, it'll be a reminder, right? Because God likes to remind us, right? But for other people, it might be a revelation. It's okay either way, because if you need it, get it, right? And if he brought you here, he wants you to have it, right? So when you're going on the journey, you need some things, right? What do you need? Call it out. No. I'm talking about the spiritual journey. We done forget about the toothbrush. They sell toothbrushes. Nowadays, you can pick up your pocketbook, get your keys, and go. Anywhere you go, they got it, right? Yeah, please. I may do. Believe me, I may do without my garments. Don't worry about that. What do you really need for the journey? You need faith. But you need faith in who? And what God is that? You got to know what kind of God you serve, right? He's an almighty God. He's a loving God. He's a faithful God. Some people serve a lesser God. That's the God that's not there when you need him. That's the God that only cares about the bad things you did. That's the God that remembers where you came from and holds it against you. Not that God. We're talking about the God that loves you with an everlasting love. We're talking about the God that forgave you all your sins and made you new. We're talking about the God that heals all your infirmities. That's the God that you got to serve and believe in, right? The one that's a very present help in the time of trouble. The one that never leaves you nor forsakes you. That's the God that you want to serve, right? You want him in the journey? Yeah. You want him in the Tesla, Honda, whatever you got. You want him in there with you? Yeah. But you know the good thing about our God? He wants to be there with you. He said, if you draw near to me, I'll draw near to you. Right? How do you draw near to God? Prayer? You got to get into the Word. Let's start with prayer, right? Now, most of y'all, some of y'all are married. But let's go back, a little further back, when you weren't married, right? And he was your boyfriend, your fiancé. And for some of y'all that want to be married again, we're talking about him. He better be your boyfriend than your fiancé. What'd you do to get close to him? You spent time with him. You talked to him. Some of y'all talk too much. But you talk to him. You spend time with him. Do you think that God will ever say, you talk too much? You spend too much time with me? No. Some of y'all might have drawn his name on your notebook. Some of y'all might have been sitting in class, should have been paying attention, were thinking about him. Have you been thinking about God the way you thought about him? What are you thinking about these days? It's just a reminder. In this journey, you're going to want him with you, but he wants to be on your mind and he wants to be in your heart. Amen? Pray to God. Talk to him. He hears you. The prayer that the pastor prayed was a funny prayer. But you know what? God heard that prayer too. You know, he hears that kind of prayer. He hears a prayer where it's just a tear. He hears a prayer when you know the scripture. He hears a prayer when you misquote the scripture. He hears a prayer when you're broken down. He hears a prayer when you pray against your enemy, when you're supposed to pray for them. He hears and he answers prayers. Amen? Don't lose sight of that. The most important person in all existence hears you. He hears you. When your teenagers don't hear you, when your boss doesn't hear you, when even you don't like you, he loves you. Amen? He's on that journey with you. He's in that car with you. Amen? So after prayer, we got the word. Oh, God, help me. If we ain't got the word, what do we have? How many people believe that the word is really from God? I know some people who talk to me about being Christians and they don't believe the word of God. They're like, it was written by a man. Well, certainly it was written by a man. God is important. He ain't got to sit there and type out the Bible for nobody. I mean, come on. If you a big CEO, are you typing your own letters? No. I mean, don't let me get somewhere in life. I'll never type again. Never, never, ever, ever, ever will I type again. What? I'll be sitting there, I'll be like, oh, no. Even a yes, I won't type. That's why some of us stay where we at. That's why we stay where we at, because we ain't got no sense. Oh, Jesus. It's not being recorded, right? Don't tell the pastor, Lord. Don't tell my pastor. Okay, you see, the women's conference is when you can come out and let yourself out, right? I have no behavior. I do not drink caffeine. I do eat sugar, but anyway. The Word of God is inspired by God. It's the book that he has given you to almost every question that you might have about life. Should you depend on it? Yeah. Should you read it every day? Sure. How many people like to read? That's all right. If you don't like to read, that's okay. You can watch it on TV. You can get an audio book. I love to read. But I'm going to tell you the truth. Most of what I'm reading is not that good for me compared to what? The Word of God. What does the Word of God teach you? His what? His promises. What else? How to live. Why are the promises of God so important? Because they're true. Tell me why. Why do you care about promises? How many people have had someone break a promise to them? Listen, I'm divorced. He broke his promise. He broke it. And I broke the marriage. That was it. But you know what? God doesn't break his promises. What are some of his promises? He'll be with you. He'll never leave me or forsake me. He's coming back. Woo! And when he comes, ooh, God. He said, the same way that I leave, I will return. That's a promise. What else does he promise you? That he loves you. You know, there's that song, what the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's true. It's true. The holidays are approaching. But even when it's just a regular day, what do we all need? Is it not love? Aren't we all seeking love? Sometimes just seeking in the wrong places, right? The kind of love that we want, we really can only get from God, right? That kind of, no matter what I look like, love, no matter what I smell like, love, no matter how I come at you, love, that's that God love, right? Sometimes, you know, you be sitting there, you be wanting your kids to love you, I'll be like, come on, please love me. No, mom, leave me alone. Can I get some space? I don't want space. You were in me. I want to be close to you. No. Fine. Let me just go with God. God will never say, Sret, back away from me. Get away from me. Go brush your teeth. Go wash your face. He won't say that, right? Those are the promises of God, right? When do you need those promises? All jokes aside, when do you need them? All the time. All the time. You need them when you get a bad report from the doctor. You need them when the bills ain't paid. You need them when the marriage is failing, no matter how much you've prayed. You need them when that child that you raised in the church is not acting right, is going astray. You need them when you can't get pregnant, or you can't find the guy that you love. You need them, right? You need them when your sister is sick and dying, and she's your best friend. You need God, right? You really need him. You need him when COVID is taking so many people and you're filled with anxiety and fear because you don't know what to do. It's airborne. All you do is breathe air. What are you supposed to do? My God. And you sit up in your house and then they tell you you got to go back to the office. You're like, oh, Lord, but there's air in the office. And it's in the air. So what do? You put on 4 masks, but still. Then you can't breathe. So what do? You're like, I can't breathe the air, but I need the air. So you need some promises. He said he'd be with you. He said he'd be your buckler and your shield. He said he'll go before you. He said that, right? You got to know the promises of God. Are you going to learn them on Sunday only? One day out of the week? I've heard it said, do you eat one day out of the week? You can look at me. I don't eat one day of the week. You might say, is there a day of the week you don't eat? But let's not get carried away. Only when necessary. Only when necessary. It's cultural. It's cultural, right? It's cultural. Okay, so we have the word. You got to spend time in the word. And now you got to believe the word, right? So let me tell you, I was like, what time is it? I don't know what time I got till, but we're going to do this. So I was in the city with a girlfriend. Let me make sure you understand. We's Christian women. She's a girlfriend, okay? Nothing else now. I was in the city. I was going to say, we're going to go see a play in the city. I ain't been to the city in 100 years. Grew up in Brooklyn, living on Long Island, forgot the city. You know how you do? You forget where you came from. Anyway, so I go into the city. I'm going to drive. I'm not going to take the train. No, I'm not going to do that. I'm grown. I'm going to drive. Grown fool that I was. I'm gonna drive into the city. I'll find parking. I believed I was gonna find parking. I believed I was gonna find parking. Well, anyway, so I said I'm gonna go into Harlem. I didn't find no parking in Harlem. Hey, no parking in Harlem. So now we're gonna go into like 43rd Street. I know I'm gonna find parking. I said, I believe I'm going to find parking. Now, there were 10 million people on the street that day. Were all of you there that Saturday? It was last week's Saturday. Did anybody see a white car? Because I said it was 10 million people in the city. Okay, and I was sitting there, I was like, oh my God, I need parking. My leg was hurting. I need parking. So I started praying. And my sister, she was like, when she heard me pray, she was like, oh, wait a minute. You think you're going to find parking? I said, hold on, wait. I'm in the middle of my prayer, and she starts doubting. I was like, you can't do that. And not in the middle of my prayer. You can't do it. I said, you can't do that. And remember, if two or more touch and agree on anything, it'll be done. So she starts doubting. I was like, I needed the two. I needed you to be two. And she bailed on me. So I said, okay, forget you. I'm a believe. And I'm a believe God, because I believe that the steps of a righteous man are ordered by the Lord. And so I said, God, you know my heel hurting. I can't get far. I'm going to this play. It's her birthday gift. Help me, Lord. Help me. So I start driving. I didn't kill anybody. That was a miracle in and of itself. I mean, I was surrounded. They swarmed by people. And I get on the block, one block from the theater. There was a parking garage. I said, oh, I should drive into the parking garage. But I said, nah, I believe God for street parking, because I'm not paying for no parking garage. Hello? I don't know about nobody else. I will drive for 30 minutes and look for parking, waste 30 minutes of gas, but I will not pay for parking. Hello? Don't record this. I won't pay for no parking. So I drove past the garage because I was standing on that prayer. Ooh, it was going on 7 o'clock. And when I drove past them, all I saw were like empty spots of street parking. I was like, whoa. And to my right and to my left, I was like, whoa. I got excited. And I have a big SUV too. Whoa. I was like, oh, I could park anywhere. So my friend was like, you probably can't park. You better read the sign. I parked my car, my 7-passenger car, parked it right by the sign, jumped out, and I tried to read it. And guess what it was? It was parking. And it was parking on my right side. There was parking on my left side. And I said to my friend, I said, look at this. This is something small. This is parking. But how many of us have something big that we need from God and we doubt God? I'm here to remind you, if he can give you parking, he can give you a child. If he can give you parking, he can give you your husband. If he can give you parking, he can restore your marriage. If he can give you parking, he can give you that promotion, that house, that apartment, whatever you have need of. Can he do it? Yes, he can. Was that Bob the Builder? Hold on now. Wait a minute. Now remember, that's the journey. Now, why do you think God did that? He wants to show his glory. God is good. He just does good stuff. He's just good like that. He doesn't even need a reason, right? It's not like I fasted and prayed for parking. I didn't do that. I mean, I would, but I didn't have to. You know what I'm saying? I didn't do it. He's just good like that. And I wish that everybody remembered the goodness of God. Because if you remember the goodness of God as you travel through this life, the trip would be more pleasurable, right? It would be a better trip. It would be a joyful trip, right? Have you ever gone on a trip with a miserable person? Don't look at your neighbor. I don't want no situations in the house of God. No situations in the house of God. Okay? Now, if you that miserable person, receive your correction. Nobody likes to go on a trip with a miserable person. Oh, if the temperature ain't right, can you turn down the music? Can you change the music? What about this seat? Can it go back? No. Sit yourself down. Relax. You're lucky you're getting a ride, okay? Can we tell them that? You're lucky you're getting a ride. Just relax, right? We got a long way to go. What do you mean you want to use the bathroom? We just got in the car. Can you just sit down? Can you relax? Oh, is that my children? Is that me? Anyway, you don't want to go nowhere with miserable people. No, everything's a problem. If it's sunny outside, it's a problem. The AC's too cold. The seat is hard. I'm just like, oh my gosh, we got a long way to go. At least 10 minutes in the car with this person, I got to go. But imagine a lifetime. Imagine if God has a ride with you for a lifetime, and all you do is complain. Oh God, when you gonna bless me, God? How come I ain't got what I asked for? I wanted a house. You don't make enough money for the house. Oh, but I wanted that house. Oh, but I wanted that man. He's not even a good man, but I asked for him. Oh, but I wanted 10 children. But you don't really want 10 children. But I asked for it, God. Have you ever asked for something, not even realizing it was no good to you? Oh, God. Then you wonder why he doesn't answer every prayer. It's for your good. He knows the end of something even from the beginning, right? He knows why he didn't give you that promotion in the Bronx when you live at Suffolk County. It's a 4-hour commute. What are you asking for? What were you asking for? Really? I mean, just really, what were you asking for? How many? I wanted that mansion on the hill. The mansion costs $6,000 a month. What are you going to do? Work 10 jobs. 10 jobs to pay for the mansion. God knows what you have need of. God will bless you. He said, no good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. If you ask for it, and if you don't get it, it might not be time. But if you continuously ask for it and you haven't gotten it, he has something better in mind. But you gotta what? You gotta trust him. You gotta trust him. You gotta trust him, right? You can pour all your trust in God. And then don't make the ride miserable for him. Oh God, don't complain and whine. Do we remember what he did in Israel? When the people were complaining after he delivered them from slavery and brought them out of Egypt. I mean, out of slavery. How long were they slaves?
400 years.
How long were they in the wilderness? Probably a minute. It was a minute. They went through the sea. How? Whoa. God is so good. He didn't just make a way. He made a dry way. You know, like, I wouldn't have thought of that. I would have been like, okay, go through the sea, we'll build boats. No. He made a way. He lifted up the ocean, I mean, the sea, it was up and beautiful. If you've seen The Prince of Egypt, you know how it looks. If you ain't got no imagination, it was up. And then he dried the land between it. So you could drag your carts and your chickens and your goats. He did all that. And as soon as they got to the other side, they were like, oh. What did they complain about? What did they want? What kind of food? They wanted who? They wanted meat. They wanted food. Then when they got meat and food, they were like, oh, it's the same meat. It's the same food. Oh, how many people get tired of eating lasagna? Okay, what's your favorite food? What's your favorite food? Chicken? You said just chicken? Oh, fried chicken. Ah. What else? Salmon. What else? Lobster, rice and peas? Rice and beans. If you're from the West Indies, it's rice and peas. But if you're Hispanic, it's rice and beans. Ah, vamos, vamos. Right? Are you going to ever get tired of eating that? And you guys are proving it because you've been eating it all your life. I tell you, I ain't never seen a group of people that can cook the food and then go to the same restaurant and eat the same food. My gosh. But I'm not judging nobody. I don't want no trouble. I don't want no troubles. I'm just saying, I know people who cook that food. And then you'd be like, oh, what we gonna eat? We gonna eat that food. Okay. So no, God doesn't like complainers. It doesn't mean that you can't tell him what you want, but you can't complain. Because you see, that messes up your ride in life. That messes up your journey. Because guess what? He's in the car, but you're in yourself. And you hear yourself. Do you ever hear yourself saying some nonsense and say to yourself, what in the world? You know, like, what in the world are you saying to yourself? I wish I had my PowerPoint. I would have told y'all. There are certain things you want to do to improve joy, but there are certain things you don't want to do because they take away joy. When you get up in the morning, and you slept hard, and, you know, your face is mushed, and you got some dry stuff on the side, what are you looking at yourself talking about, oh, you ain't beautiful? What do you mean? Why would you want to look for beauty then? I mean, come on, just wash your face. Like why? Why would you do that? Like why? Like, you know how you get up, you look in the mirror, you're like, oh, you don't look so good. You're looking old. No, you're looking tired. You just woke up. Wash your face, brush your teeth, comb your hair, and let's try that again. Don't do that to yourselves. Don't do that to yourselves. Part of being able to enjoy the journey is learning how to love yourself, right? What did God say? He said you ought to love your neighbor. He didn't say just love your neighbor, forget about yourself. But some of us, we love everybody but ourselves, especially women, right? I'm gonna tell you something. Well, there's only one, maybe two men in the room. Y'all keep it quiet, keep it secret. Don't go telling nobody on the outside. But one of the things I admire about men is, for the most part, they're not as hung up on themselves as we are. You know, like men, they be looking like men. And you know, and God made everybody beautiful, but I'm just saying that men be looking like men, and they be like, I look like a man. They be like, I know you want this. You want this, all of this, all of that. They be all right with that. You know, I ain't gonna knock a person while they down, but there have been some men, they ain't got nothing to offer. That's just being honest. They ain't got much to offer, but they be coming up like you gotta consider me. And I thought, oh, really? What you got? What you got to offer? He was like, I got me. I'm like, oh. I like that. I don't know about y'all, but I like that. All you got is you. You feel good about you. I like that. Why can't we be like that? Why we can't be like that? Why we gotta lose 20 pounds before we happy? Why we gotta gain 20 pounds before we happy? Why we gotta put on the lipstick before we happy? Why we gotta have a certain amount of hair before we happy? Why we gotta make a certain amount of money before we happy? Why do we have to have a certain amount of kids before we happy? Why? Why do a certain amount of people have to like me for me to love me? Come on. Come on. That affects the journey. If some of you have started to grow weary, if some of you have started not to enjoy your lives, if some of you feel stuck in the same place, feel like, what is my life all about? Is it even worth it? I submit to you that you might be the problem, right? It's not your life. I'm going to share a little bit something about my life. I have a very good friend who says to me, if you ain't been through what I've been through, you ain't qualified to talk to me. And so I'm going to talk to you about my life before Christ, because I have a BC and I have a, you know, an AD. I was before Christ and then I came to Christ. Amen. And for me, it was a blessing to have not always been a Christian. I wish I would have known Jesus my whole life. I tell my kids all the time, you don't know. I wish I could have been like you. But you know what? I can't even say that. Because half of the love I have for God is because I realized what it was like when I didn't have him. And so when I met him, my gosh, woo! You know, I look on, there ain't nobody taping, right? I think somebody's taping back there. Just don't show my face, okay? But you know, if you look on like the TikToks, you see things that are called like thirst traps. And thirst traps are things that get people like, oh, I wish I had that. you know, when I met Jesus, I was like, my God, that was like the best trap ever. He was like the best thing to me ever. You see, I was born in Panama. I lived in Panama. I was there until I was 4 years old. And then my dad came to America. And when he came to America, he sent for my mom and for me. So I came to America, coming to America. Don't watch that movie, don't watch that movie. I came to America when I was 5. I came to New York for a minute. And then from there, we went to Germany. Because my dad was in the military, right? So in Germany, I had to learn English. I had to learn German. From the time I was 5 until I was 11, I changed schools every single year, maybe twice a year. Around the time when I was 9, my mom got sick. I didn't know what she had. I was 9 years old. She was sick. We were in Colorado at that time, and we had to run to Germany. I don't know why, because, you know, when you're a kid and the adults are moving, they're not giving you any answers. So I grew up just knowing one day I come home from school, and that might be the day I'm jumping on a plane going somewhere else, right? And so that was my life. I just never knew when I was going to move. I didn't know when I would see my friends again. And so I come home, and sure enough, we're off to Germany. Now, at that time, it was my parents, and we had a dog. Now, Muffy, he was a mix, but he was a hot mess. And so Muffy had some kind of behaviors, and he had to be left. And then Muffy had to be put down. So in Germany, when my mom is sick, my mom starts crying. I'm like, what happened? She was like, Muffy had to get put down. And she started crying, and I was shocked because she complained about Muffy every single day. I said, oh, is that some kind of like a love hate? What is that, you know? But again, the dog got put down. We're in Germany. Next thing I know, we're back. Wait, we go from Germany. I don't know what happened. I guess my dad must have started getting sick too. And you know, again, they don't tell you anything, right? If you have kids, talk to them. Talk to your kids. Don't let them grow up not knowing today from tomorrow. Talk to them. If they're 5, talk to them as a 5-year-old. If they're 10, talk to them like a 10-year-old. But talk to your kids. So all of a sudden, we're in Germany, now we're in Panama. And I'm like, whoa! And I'm in Panama, and I'm surrounded by a bunch of people who speak Spanish. Now, in my house, my mom spoke Spanish to me, but you know, I didn't speak no Spanish. I didn't speak back to her in Spanish. And so I understood Spanish, and what I was talking was not Spanish. So I get to Panama, where, you know, and I'm talking to all these family members. I don't know what I was saying, but they were just like, uh-huh, mm-hmm. But my mom is getting worse. And my mom ends up in the hospital. Now, come to find out, we went to Panama because my grandma was there. Her mother was there. So my grandma's taking care of my mom. But she's getting worse. My dad looks fine. But he's, you know, he's working. He's still in the service. We're in Panama. My mom gets really bad. By the time I last saw my mom, she couldn't even see. She had lost her hair. She didn't even know who I was. My mom had AIDS. That was back in the 80s, mid-80s. I remember going to the hospital sometimes with my mom, and they used to make us wear gowns, and I was like, I'm not wearing a gown to see my mom. And they'd be like, don't touch her. And they used to be so scared, and I'm like, why are you scared? It's my mom. But they were scared. They didn't know what AIDS was. You know how we didn't know what COVID was? They didn't know what AIDS was. All I knew was that was my mom, right? My mom dies. I think a week after my mom dies, my dad pulls up at my grandma's house. I get in the car. I'm in New York. I didn't say goodbye. I didn't pack a box. I'm in New York. Where am I? I'm with his mom. I never met her. I'm with his brothers. I ain't never heard about these people. I was like, hello, hello. My mom is gone. I'm looking at these people. Not the way I'm looking at y'all, don't worry. Not the way I'm looking at y'all. And I'm in New York. My dad goes to work. Next thing I know, my dad is in the hospital because my dad is sick. My dad has AIDS. My dad's in the hospital. I can't see him in the hospital. I don't even know where he was. I think he was in Virginia. Next thing I know, my dad is gone. I lost my mom when I was 10. I lost my dad when I was 12. I'm left with someone, never knew her. I didn't know New York, Yeah. How many people know New York is very different from Germany? Very different. My life in New York was very different from my life on a base, in different places. I don't know anybody. I lost hope. I started to get depressed. I said, what do I have in life? I don't have parents. I won't have anybody walk me down the aisle. I won't have anyone at graduation. I have the mind of a child, right? But how many adults feel the same way? How many adults have lost hope? But God is the God of hope. Now, it just so happens that when I was growing up, there used to be some neighbors that would take me to church every now and again. I don't remember too much because my life was like a blur. But I did remember having faith in God, right? And I remember, at one point, I remember saying, ha, I believe in God, but who's this Jesus? I was like, who's that? This man made God? I was like, But you know, the very same Holy Spirit said, you better believe in that Jesus. And I didn't understand it because I wasn't being taken to church. But in my mind, I said, okay, I'll accept you too. I'll take Jesus and I'll take God. I'll take both of you. It wasn't until I was 23 years old that somebody invited me to church and I gave my heart to the Lord. It took me all those years to come to Christ. The church that I got saved at is actually the same church that one of our worship leaders, I met her there. It's a small world. It's a small world. When I was outside of Christ, holidays were difficult for me. Thanksgiving was the worst holiday for me. I didn't have family. My grandma was working. She was young. Thank God for my grandma. She's like everything to me now. The stranger became everything to me, right? And so holidays were hard. I would go to Panama every year. I finally learned to hablar español. Tuve que aprender, tuve que estudiar. I had to learn to speak because I was hurting people's ears. It was just embarrassing, right? And so I came to faith in God. And when I came to faith in God, God gave me joy. Oh my God, the story didn't change. I still didn't have parents, but all of a sudden I had joy. I started enjoying life. I started doing things. I started looking at the brighter side of things. What do they say? I had, what is it? Rosy-colored glasses. Everything looked different. If you're a Christian and your life doesn't look good to you, look again. Look again. If all you see are the problems and the circumstances, I dare you to look again. Amen? Listen, I got married. Some people know the story. They know some of the story. We'll tell those details another time if they let me back up here. I got married. I had a child. I had two children. My husband and I were so different. If I said it was Tuesday, he said it was Wednesday. I was like, what? I didn't understand. Then he asked me to cook. I was like, cook? What are you talking about? Cook? Yeah, last story, prompt. It must have been like the first week in our new apartment. He got hungry. I got hungry. I'm looking at him. He's looking at me. And I'm like, why are you looking at me? Are you gonna go buy some food? he was like a West Indian man. When I was growing up in my grandma's house, I only passed by the kitchen to get my plate. I only came out my room to test. You know, you just be testing stuff. You just, oh, it tastes good. You could serve that. I didn't know anything. And when that man looked at me, he was like, you gonna cook? I was like, ooh, this is bad. This is real bad. Ooh. But you know, I prayed, because how many people know prayer changes things? And I lifted my hands and I said, God, help me with this chicken. Help me, help me, help me, help me, help me. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. Help me with the beans. I don't know what I was like, oh, God, help me. Help me, because I was having a baby. He was at work. I was like, I guess it's my turn to cook because I'm home. And I really didn't know what I was doing. Only God kept us alive those first few years. food poisoning, all sorts of contamination. Oh, it was ugly. But God, but God, but God. And now I'm a master chef. Hallelujah. Oh, God. Oh, God. You name it, I could cook it. Tell me what you want. I can cook it. Oh, God. Part of experiencing joy is also trying new things, right? I dare you to try something new. If you're not happy, try something that'll make you happy, okay? It's okay. You can go to the restaurant. You like nuggets? That's okay. But you can try something else. You know how to cook? That's great. You don't know how to cook? Learn. You want to learn how to do something? How many people like to learn new things? Don't stop learning. Don't stop growing. That anointing, it'll help you with everything. It'll make you a painter. It'll make you a carpenter. It'll make you a plumber. It'll make you a hairstylist. Oh, God, you thought it was YouTube? It's not YouTube, it's God, right? He'll do anything. You can do all things. He will bless the work of your what? Your hands. Listen, life is to be enjoyed. The word for today is from Nehemiah. The joy of the Lord is our strength. If God can be joyful, ought we not to be joyful, right? God is having a good time, and he sees all the bad. We don't even imagine what he sees, right? We can't imagine what he knows. But even in spite of all that, he's having a good time. Because one day we'll all be with him, right? And he's looking forward to that. And we should be looking forward to that too, right? But even as the days go by, he's blessing you. He's strengthening you. You know, joy is a strength, right? How many people like to be with happy people, right? My God. My God. If you had to choose between grumpy Surette or happy Surette on the ride of life, who are you going to choose? Happy Surette. Don't worry about it. If I was burning the pot, I was happy. I was burning the pot. I was like, ooh, I guess that was too high. Let's try again. Ooh. Or if you cook it longer, it doesn't get brown. Ooh. It gets black. Okay. Okay. I had to learn that. I had to learn it. But I didn't kill myself about it. I was like, oh, here you go, messing up the pot again. No, I didn't do that. I was like, oh, okay. You don't. Note to self. Cooking it longer doesn't make it brown. You got to do that. You got to do that. You got to be good to yourself. How many know you got to be good to others? You know that a lot of your joy is even in how you perceive yourself. You know, some of us are so grumpy and mean to people. And you know that affects how you see yourself. Be good to your neighbors. Be good to strangers. I've heard people say, like, if you don't say thank you when you open the door for you, I'm going to throw the door. Don't do that. Don't do that, because you ain't going to like you. Be good to people. It will make you feel good about yourself. When you do good, you feel good. Because you were designed to do what? Good works. He said there were works that he predestined for you to do. So do them. Right? You will see your joy increase. Serve in your church. Volunteer in your community. Those things make you feel good. When you look down, you know how sometimes you're tired? But you're tired because you're lazy. You ain't done did nothing. You know how you get up from a nap, you be like, oh, I'm tired. I'm going to go lay back down. No. But if you've been helping people, if you've been talking to your neighbors, if you've been spending time with that sister, get on your nerves, you feel better. You feel better, right? Don't just hang out with people to make you happy now. Minister to those who need someone to teach them how to be happy. You see how all y'all are here? Now go take that sunshine somewhere else, because there are a whole bunch of people who need that, right? They need to hear you saying good things. That'll encourage them. That'll convict them, right? You ever seen that person, oh, this Mercedes is so old. It's like 3 years old. Oh, I got to get a new one. My God. Tell them, oh, I wish I had a Mercedes. I've had this Camry. I have a Camry for so long. Maybe if they hear that from you, they won't feel so bad about the Mercedes, right? Treat people good. Love God. Read His word. Trust Him, right? Enjoy the journey.
Get enough of your love, Jesus.
Never get enough of your love.
feel extra blessed today because my son is here on the piano, rocking the sweater. You see, you can get it for your child too. And that's a blessing for me because my family's just a part of what we do. So while we're standing, I'm just gonna ask Pastor D to come as we do our closing session. It's been good. You guys enjoyed the food? Enjoyed your time talking with one another? We need this, we need this.
Among family, it'll work out. I forgot to tell you one thing, and just look at your sister, your beautiful, magnanimous, awesome sister, and say, I'm so glad to see your face in the place. Did I tell you that you really look good at what you got on? Worthy to be praised at during the break. I got a chance to talk with some of you, and I appreciate the love that you have shown me here. I feel at home, and if I just wasn't in love with Harvest Fields at 2626 Tremont, I might come on over here in the boogie down Bronx. But I'm part of an incredible team of incredible pastors, and I just want to shout out to my sisters, Eunice and Eliana. They came with me today. You will see how they'll be participating in the message. They gave up their Saturday to be here, and I just want you to know that I appreciate it. And if I get too much and say too much about you, I'll start to cry in my makeup, and then maybe the eyelash will fall. We don't want to have that. I just want to tell you a fun thing about me, okay? Because this message is going to be deep. I have a grandson. His name is Liam Spencer Christian Todd. He is amazing. And so he calls me up every morning, but usually I have my makeup on. And so one day I didn't have my makeup on. And he said, hi, Nani. He said, you got a boo-boo in your face? So I also told him that Nani's knee hurt, because one knee is 40 years old, but the other one's 65. So I told him to pray for me, and he prayed. He said, Jesus, make Nani's knee good. And then about a couple weeks ago, I asked him to pray again, and he said, Nani, I already prayed for that. Jesus is going to make it right. So kudos to my daughter, Shannon, who is showing him that he has faith. I just appreciate it. This morning, we talked about how Nehemiah found joy in his journey. We said that you can't go into war alone. We said you have to fight back with the word of God. And we also said that when the enemy is attacking you and trying to have a relationship with you, that you have to remember God's voice. Remember, he said that you don't have to worry and be fearful, that I'm with you. What I love about those scriptures is this: my name is written, your name is written in the palm of my hand. There's just something about that. But so we answered that question, we did. But the next thing we're going to have to do is that we're going to have to answer another question. Let me just go where I need to be. Okay, we're going to have to answer another question. And ladies, this is going to be probably one of the most painful messages that I've ever given. Because I love for you to I love the message with the woman with the Canaanite woman. If I could just take the crumbs from the table, I remember doing that message and I had crumbs all around me. You know, I love that message. But we've come a long way. And you didn't come giving up your Saturday to hear always a feel-good message. And so this message may not make you feel so good. The question that we have to answer today is, how do you find joy and strength in your journey with God when you're broken? Leanna?
Joy. I haven't had a chance to experience that. My childhood was snatched when I was raped by my uncle. And to this day, what I have in my heart is anger. And I still have it. Anger for both my uncle and especially my mom, who ignored all my pleas for help. How dare she? I was her baby. She was supposed to protect me.
Oh, I had joy. You couldn't tell me nothing. I was walking in the plan that God had for me. There was nothing that I couldn't do. I believed that I could fly until I found a lump in my breast. They had to do a double mastectomy. And all I do now is live in fear that I'm going to die the way my mother did of cancer. I'm broken.
Hey. Hi. I got joy. I found joy in my boo, my fine husband. Don't be looking at him. He's so cute. And he's a drummer, too. You know musicians, right? Till one day, I found out that he was cheating on me. You know with who? With my best friend. My bestie, my BFF. Oh, that memory. That memory of betrayal plays over and over and over in my mind. I close my eyes and I can just see. Couldn't get out of bed, stop eating, till one day I got a nervous breakdown.
Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come today to continue to give you glory and honor, even in the midst of our brokenness. Now, Father, when you gave me this message, I did question, can there be something else? Can I talk about something else? And he said, no. You said no because your daughters were broken. So today, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus
and that you take away the pain that your daughters are experiencing because of their brokenness. Today, let this word fall on good ground. Today, Father, let them walk away whole in Jesus' name. Amen. Brokenness. It's a condition in which something is badly damaged and unable to continue. Brokenness. It gives birth to anxiety and depression, low self-esteem, and suicidal thoughts. And if you don't confront brokenness, the devil will take advantage of you in a conversation based on lies. In the morning session, I told you that you have to fight back with the word of God about when you're broken and so depressed and can't get out of the bed. It's hard to fight back. And when you're in that bed and you're cuddled up and you're just feeling like everything is coming against me and I can't even do anything. I can only get up and go to the bathroom. I can't even get in the shower. That's when the devil attacks you. It's like he has his foot on your neck, and we know how that feels based on what happened this summer. This is what he says. You're believing God for healing, but how long have you been having those anxiety attacks? How long have you been on those antidepressants? It looks like you're getting worse and you're not getting better. Am I the only one who's been in that type of season? This is not the time that you jump up and say, oh yeah, that was me. No, it's not that type. This is not that type of message. But I find when you find yourself identifying with what I said, I have some good news. You're in the right place. You're in the right place where God can bring you from broken to being whole. Many women in the Bible who received deliverance or a word from God came from brokenness. They came to him broken. Now, many scholars would tell you that the woman with the issue of blood brought her to a place of depression. But when I think about that thing, having a period, that's what it really was. It's so nice when they said an issue of blood, it was a period. We can't handle a period for 5 days. Can you imagine having one for 12 years? When I think about how she went to doctor after doctor. Oh, yeah, we're going to heal you. Don't worry about it, sis. And then she ran out of money and didn't have any place to go. I came to the conclusion that she wasn't desperate. She was broken. Her brokenness fueled her depression to risk her life, to save her life, which gave birth to faith to Jesus, saying, you know the scripture, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I will be made whole. Sarai, or now we know her as Sarah, she was Abraham's wife. For years I said, you know what, she was crazy. Now think about it, we ladies. I'm going to tell my maidservant to sleep with my husband so that we can have a baby. Don't you think that's crazy? I mean, for years, I said, you know, that child done lost her mind. I can just hear my mother saying, that child was crazy. If she thought that cockamamie idea was going to work. But when I thought about it, that she desired a child for years and years, she was getting old, 70s, 80s, her womb was drying up. I came to the conclusion that she wasn't crazy, she was, say it with me, broken. The Bible says in Luke, let me just turn it here. The Bible says in Luke that there was this woman, she was bent over for 18 years. Now, I know you just had lunch, but I want you to stand up. And I want you to bend over.
And then I want you to imagine going to the bathroom bent over, cooking bent over, going to work bent over. I want you to imagine that every single conversation that you have with people, you're bent over. You may be seated. You see, when she entered the synagogue, she was more than sick from the years of living her life in that condition. She was, say it with me, she was broken. I could go on and on about examples of women who were broken and were made whole, but the story I want to focus on is Hannah. It's a familiar story in 1 Samuel. Elkanah was his name, and he had two wives, Peninnah, and he had Hannah. And Peninnah, she was popping out babies left and right. Every time you seen her, she was pregnant. But then here is Hannah. She couldn't have any babies. The Bible said she was barren. And in those days, many Israelites believed children were a gift from the Lord or a sign of his blessing. So it was only natural that Hannah would be upset that she didn't have any children. People looked down at Hannah. She ain't had no baby. She must have did something because the Lord don't like her. You know how people can talk about you. Oh, my goodness, she ain't got a husband yet. Everybody in her family been married, but she ain't been married. Must be something wrong with her. Is she one of, as my aunt said, one of them things? That's what they say. I'm just telling you what, I'm just saying we can keep it real in a conference. Every year, they left their homes to go to a place called Shiloh. It was a public place where everyone traveled once a year to worship God and offer him sacrifices. Elkanah, when they went to Shiloh, he would give Peninnah more meat than he would give Hannah because Hannah was barren. And Peninnah, she was, as you know, popping out babies left and right. To make matters worse, Peninnah would torment and humiliate her, especially when they went to Shiloh to worship. It got so bad that Hannah would cry and refuse to eat. One day, after they had finished the meal, she became deeply depressed, and she cried out, and she cried out to the Lord. Yeah. When your brokenness puts you in a season of depression, you will cry out to the Lord the way Eunice did when her husband cheated on her with her best friend. I can hear Hannah praying right now. Father God Almighty, look at your servant. I am in pain. Father, do not forget me. Look at my agony. See what I'm going through. I want a child. Is there any way that you could give me this child? Because I want this child so bad. I promise you, if you would just give me a child, I'll give them back to you. Who does that? I've been praying for God for a husband for decades, and I say, but God, when my Boaz comes, okay, when he comes to me, I'm going to say no, because I want to please you. Who does that? Is a servant of God, a true worshiper who acknowledges him as Lord and Savior. Even in her pain, think about this. Even in her pain, her humiliation, she was willing to give up the very thing that she wanted. This is worship. It's easy to praise him. Father, I just thank you for what you did. You woke me up this morning and allowed me to see another day. God, I just want to thank you for life, health, and strength. I want to thank you for my job. I want to thank you for my car. I want to thank you for my house. But do you know how difficult
it is to worship him when you can't stop crying because you are in so much pain? Can you imagine calling on the names of God? Father, you are. You're the Holy One of Israel. You're the counselor called Wonderful. I come today to worship you in my pain. That's a different type of worship. Imagine how hard it was for Mary. You know, Mary, her sister was Martha, and her brother was Lazarus. And everybody knew they were close to Jesus. So, of course, when they called on Jesus because their brother was sick, of course he would show. You know the story. Jesus didn't show up. Lazarus died. You would think that Jesus would show up for the wake. He didn't even show up for the wake. Oh, he's got to show up for the funeral and do the eulogy because Lazarus was his best friend. He didn't even show up for that. He comes up 4 days later. When Mary heard that Jesus was there, the Bible says she knelt down. That was a form of worship to him in her pain. I don't understand why you did not come. We called on you. Our brother died, but yet she worshiped him. Yeah. And he didn't forget her. Well, you know the story. He raised her brother from the grave after stinking there for 4 days. And he did not forget Hannah. The Bible says in Samuel 3 and 4, when they returned from Shiloh, remember that's the place, the public place of worship, Hannah conceived a child and named him Samuel. And after she weaned him, she returned him back to that public place of worship. Ah, oh, look at me now. Where you at, Penaniah? With your little crazy kids, baby kids. Where you at? Okay. Look at my child. She did exactly what she promised. She weaned him. She took care of him. But she brought him back. And she brought him back to Eli, the high priest. And the reason why that part of the story is so important, because Eli was the one that said, when she was crying and crying out to the Lord in that bitter cry, you know, that's the cry when you get ugly. That's the cry when you don't care if your eyelashes fall off. That's the cry when you get up and you ain't brushed your teeth out, but you're crying out to the Lord. You got to get me out of this pain. There's no way that I can handle this anymore. You got to come now. She brought him back to Eli. And she said, remember me? Remember the woman you thought was drunk and you told me to get myself together? I had a baby and I made God this promise and I'm bringing him back the way I said. And guess what they did? They worshiped together. So there's a question that we need to answer now. If you want to find joy in your journey, strength from the Lord in your journey, you're going to have to exchange your brokenness for wholeness. You have to be willing to give up whatever is causing you pain. It's difficult. It's difficult to do it. You know, I believe that all of you showed me love until about now. All of a sudden, you set me up, Pastor D, because I thought we was going to be, woo! Yeah. No, this is a women's conference. Can you imagine Pastor Malazzo or Pastor Mitchell talking about this? Because in a church setting, everybody's there. Men, women, you know everybody. And so they're getting a word from the Lord that's going to touch everybody. But in a women's conference, I just got one audience. And it's women. And I believe that you did not come to this conference spending your whole day waiting in line for Chick-fil-A to hear me say it's going to be okay. You didn't get up early this morning. See, I fasted on your behalf. And I'm not trying to brag, don't think I am, because giving up food for you was a lot of you, I didn't even know you.
I started to break the fast at 2 o'clock and say, I'm going to go to Kennedy's and get me some fried chicken. I started to do that. But the fast was more important, than the food. Not having a baby was causing Hannah pain. When she released the pain and turned it into a sacrifice, God answered her prayer. I want you to think about that. I want you to think about what breaks you. Things that you're holding on to. Yeah, just let that sit for a moment. It isn't that you don't love God, because you do. It's just this part of the relationship, this brokenness. In order for me to survive, I had to hide it. In order for me not to not beat my husband for what he went and put me through, I had to hide my brokenness. In order for me to deal with the people who hurt me, just lied to me. I'm a Christian. I'm a Christian. So therefore, I'm going to love you anyway. Yeah, you know how hard that is to love people who hurt you. Leanna, it was terrible about what you went through. To have your childhood snatched away from you, and for your mother not to acknowledge that that was years, you were a little girl, that was years, so you went decades and decades holding on to that. But I'm telling you that when you replace, this is different, this is difficult, when you replace your anger with forgiveness for your mom and for your dad, for your uncle, that's when God is going to heal you. He is Jehovah Rapha, the healer. It's difficult. I'm not expecting you to say, oh, yeah, I was molested at age 3, age 6, age 7. I'm ready to let it go. It's a process. I'm praying that you will let it go today, but I got to be realistic that it's a process. But if you don't confront it, you will never be completely whole. You will always walk around with a limp. You look good, but all of a sudden something triggers it. It's called PTSD or something, and you almost fall. You look at a little girl, and she's playing with her uncle, and you get, don't do that. You just go. Because it comes up. Me. When I replace my fear with love, power, and of a sound mind, that's when I will be able to tell that generational curse to go back to the pit of hell. There will never be another woman that is going to die of cancer in my family, because I'm pulling it out from the root, because I am truly believing that He is a healer. You have to make a conscious decision. You can stay in your brokenness for as long as you want, but it's going to come up. It's going to resurface somewhere. If Leanna doesn't deal with her brokenness, when she gets into a relationship and when she starts having an argument, don't touch me. Don't you dare touch me. Last time somebody touched me, they met. No, just go away. Get out of here. Eunice, when you allow God to heal your broken heart, to bind up your wounds, it's tough. Let's just be honest. Many people would have beat their best friend down, would have knocked him out. I wish you would. Because the trust, it wasn't only the trust that she had in her husband, but she was betrayed by her best friend.
But when she replaces that, you will be able to trust and love again. This is what some people say. They say, I know, just forget it, just forgive them and just forgive. People say, sticks and stones will break your bones, but words will never heal you. Those are all lies from the pit of hell. I'd rather have to be beat down and to deal with the pain for about a week than to deal with fear, to deal with being betrayed, or dealing with being molested. I'd rather take a beat down because eventually I'm going to heal. But these type of wounds, they're heart wounds. There are heart wounds, and it's difficult to heal from that. So this is what they need to do in a nutshell. They're never going to forget what happened. Never going to forget it. So that's a stupid thing to tell somebody. Just forget it, baby girl. It's all right, forget it. But when they remember it, it will be without the pain. That's when you know you have exchanged your brokenness from being whole. That's when you know. I remember when I was pregnant when I was a teenager. And I remember when I told him that I was pregnant, there were two words that he said. By who? I said, by who? You. He said two more words, not me. And I raised my daughter with the help of God and my family. I see him when I go back home to Niagara Falls. And I remember the time that he was in his fancy Mercedes Benz and he drove by and he splashed water all over my daughter. I remember that. But I don't remember the pain. Because I have forgiven him. I traded my brokenness for being whole. God said that this has to be a process. He said it has to begin. I've talked to many of you one-on-one and you're still dealing with some stuff. You're still hiding it way in here. Nobody don't see it because as long as I put on my cute face, but when you go home, you're so full of anxiety, you're so full of pain. Many of you related to staying in the bed and not getting up. It's time that you let go of this pain. It's time. Could you bring the cross up? Jesus, he took a beating on Thursday night that lasted all night long. Some say that it disfigured his face beyond recognition. And then on Friday, he willingly and without resistance, he allowed them to his accusers to hammer nails into his feet and to his hands. I want you to imagine that because that was you. When you were abused, when you were rejected, when I got the bad news, that was me being nailed to a cross. I can feel it right now. They placed a crown with 1-inch thorns on his head. They call it Good Friday. You know, we all churchy here. We know what Good Friday is. But it wasn't a Good Friday for Jesus. Think about it. On that Sunday, they were calling him, Hosanna, Hosanna, and they were just bowing down, and here we are on Friday, they're saying, crucify him. Spitting on him. Do a lot of things to me, but don't you spit on me. That's nasty. Truth be told, he could have called on his daddy and sent legions of angels to get him down, but he didn't. He endured the pain for, for years, I used to say, yeah, he endured the pain for those who did that to him. But the bottom line is that he had me and you on his mind. That's why he didn't get off that cross. He went through the pain of saying, Father, why have you forsaken me? He did that because of us. He doesn't want us to stay there. There's this song. It's by Israel. And sometimes I felt ashamed of my brokenness. Matter of fact, I wanted to get myself straight before I accepted my calling. But I love what the words that the song says. I love the way you embrace broken people like me. I love the way you embrace broken people like me. God wants us to bring our brokenness to him. He understands what you've been through. He says, listen, daughter, I'll be a very present help in the time of your trouble. I'll be your best friend that sticks closer than a brother. I'm the gentle whisper in your ear that says, I love you with an everlasting love from everlasting to everlasting. He's the captain of your salvation. He is that hiding place from the wind. That's who he is. He's my anchor when I don't think I can make it. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He healed the woman with the issue of blood. Yeah, he healed her. Sarah's womb was as old as a goat, older than water, and she produced a baby from it. Think about it. That's old when you're old as a goat. I have to make you laugh because this is a tough message. And then there's the woman that was bent over. When Jesus touched her, she got up and started praising him. That's what I want for you. This cross. Leanna, I want you to bring up your baggage. Yeah. Bring it up. Because you still got some issues with your mama and your uncle. I want you to bring it up. And I want you to leave it at the altar. I'm sorry, at the cross. Eunice. Girl, don't you know that God has a husband that will love you the way Christ loves the church? Don't you know that God has already prepared him for you, that he is the one that's going to intercede for you? He is the one that's going to pray for you. And yes, he's going to be fine. Leave it at the cross. I'm going to take some of this baggage of fear. Where did it come from? Fear that came from my uncle who died, and my brother who died of cancer, and my sister who died of cancer, and my aunt who died of cancer. It's time that I let it go. Bringing it to the cross. I'm letting it go. Now I'm going to stand in the gap for you. You're holding some things that has made you broken. Disappointments. And if truth be told, you have said to God, why have you forsaken me? if truth be told, there were times that you said, I don't understand why you didn't bless me. I was good. I gave up a lot of things. I gave up to please you. And there's some woman over there, she's been living with him for 10 years, and then they get married and you bless them with a house. I let it go. Some of you have carried brokenness for your family members. Yeah, they hurt you. And your relationship, it was like this beautiful necklace. Yeah, because you were tight with the family. But it started coming apart. I'm going to lay that at the cross. Some of you, you had dreams. They didn't come true. It started out like this beautiful necklace it was, but it got broken. And now your dream looks like this. Shattered. We have to talk about this, because if we don't, we'll never be healed. Some of you was broken by the church. And that's a different kind of hurt. Because this is what happens. You go to the church. Eunice came to the church, and Ileana came to the church when they were broken. But what happens when the place that you go to be comforted, to be loved, to be encouraged, breaks you? Oh, you don't have to say amen, but we're going to bring this to the cross. We cannot continue walking our lives on broken glass. We cannot continue to, because if I bent down, it's going to cut. If you keep the broken glass in your life, it's going to cut you. I can't continue to walk in this broken glass. I got to get it up. I got to get it up because it's getting to me. I got to get this broken glass up. It's shattered. I want you to think about the thing that you need to leave at the cross. Yeah. Now, I know COVID regulations and all of this, but can just a few of you just come up acknowledging that you're leaving some things at the cross? We're not going to put a microphone in your face and say, come on, tell us what broke you. We just need you to come. And we got to make it physical. And just if you could touch the cross as if you were leaving it there. We just come, just a few of you, because when a few of you come, it represents all of you. Come on up. Yeah, you've been dealing with some things for decades. We prayed over this. You'll be safe. I want you to just kind of, when you come up here, you're saying, I don't want to be broken all the time. I don't want to be broken all the time. God said, I know the plan that I have for you, and it doesn't include me staying broken the rest of my life. I don't want to be broken all my life. You heard those women earlier in the beginning crying out. Crying out. I just don't want to be broken. Yeah. It's that time. It's that time for you to cry out to the Lord. Because it was a lot of pain. This is the place. At the altar. The place at the altar. I want to leave with a limp. I want to leave whole.
I love the way you embrace broken people like me. I love the way you embrace broken people like me. Father God, when I got the call, I didn't expect this was the message you were going to give me. I didn't think you were going to deal with their brokenness. I had a different message. As soon as she called me, I hung up the phone. I dropped on my knees and I said, I got it. I know what you want to tell me. But later on that week, you said, that's not it. You're not going there to do a feel-good message. My daughters are hurting. We got to deal with the brokenness. They got to find strength in the worship. It's not easy to be obedient. It's not easy to have to submit. It's not easy to sacrifice, to give up that thing because we've been walking around with them for so long. But Father, it's time. In the name of Jesus, I declare your healing. You're broken. But today we're going to break every chain. Today we're going to break every chain. In the name of Jesus, we're going to break every chain. You're not going to go out the same way. You're going to have an encounter with God that's going to change your life. We're going to break every chain today. We are not going to be the same. We are going to live the latter part of our life better than our past. He's going to break every chain. And so what I want you to do is just begin to start worshiping him. It's different than praise because you're in pain. I want you to begin to worship him in your pain. Worship him in your pain. There's something about when I call on you in my pain, it's a different Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. It's that prayer that Hannah cried out in distress, crying out that bitterly thing, Jesus, I'm your servant. Heal my body. Heal my body. Heal my body. Heal my body. I know that I'm touching you. I know that I'm touching women whose hearts have been broken. But he said, I'll heal them. He promised that. He holds his word above his name. If he said it, it will come to pass. Every door that should be closed will be closed, and every door that should be open will be opened. Again, I'll say it again. You're not a survivor trying to climb up the rough side of the mountain, but you're more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. We declare right now in the name of Jesus, Father, the one that you went to the cross and that you died for us, we are not going to keep this with us. We're just not going to keep it. It's the sweet place of worship. It's the sweet place of worship. You're doing what he's called you to do, but it's still pain. That word.
worship is going to release it. Trust me. Break every chain. Father, in the name of Jesus, you said to bring your daughters to the altar, and here they are. It wasn't easy coming to this altar because you're vulnerable and you want people to think everything is okay, but you're dealing with a broken heart.
Break every chain.
Break